Good morning, and welcome to the Museum of the San Ramon Valley's virtual speaker series. I'm Dan Dunn, the director of the museum. We are over a year and a half into these programs with the virtual speaker series. Past presentations have included California's First Peoples, Then and Now, the Alamo Pioneer Cemetery, and last month, the human history of Mount Diablo on its 100th birthday. We hope that you have enjoyed these programs in this series. Today, we are happy to have local historians and authors Beverly Lane and Sharon Burke as this month's presenters. They have literally written the book on Alamo, so we are going to hear about the beginning of the area's geology and native peoples. Beverly and Sharon will tell us the story of Alamo, that community at the north end of the San Ramon Valley. We'll hear about early settlers, the origin of the Alamo name, early ranchos, title controversies, and include 20th century challenges faced by Alamo. This presentation includes many rarely seen photographs of Alamo. Please use the chat window at the bottom of the screen for any questions that you have. Feel free to send in questions anytime during the presentation, and we'll address them at the end. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce Beverly Lane and Sharon Burke. Beverly, Sharon?
Hello, and thank you so much for welcoming us onto your computers. I'm Beverly Lane, and with Sharon Burke, we are going to give you a short program with some insights on the history of Alamo. So first we look at just the front of our book, which is called Historic Tales of Alamo. And one of the things that we found that was very clear as we researched and wrote about this was what a special place this community has in county history. It had the second post office, second only to the county seat that was on the strait of Martinez. And whenever people wrote about South County, they always referenced Alamo, in part because it was a blooming little town and had that post office. So in a lot of ways, it's really a microcosm of California history, having a long history of Indians. Spanish came through early. We had Mexican ranchos. Gold Rush settlers were the first major settlers in Alamo. And because of its location between Las Trompas and the beautiful Mount Diablo, it was a wonderful agricultural spot. So one of the things that they grew were fruit. And this is a orchard in Alamo that you can see just beginning to bloom in the spring. They initially raised cattle, then they did lots of walnuts, vineyards, and of course, fruit orchards. Next. So one of the things we did in our book, which I think people will enjoy, is we recognized how long cattle had been grazed here, first by the Spanish and then by the American settlers. And even if they put other crops on the flat, they often would graze cattle in the hills and they had to have their brands. And so I'll just mention some of them here. The 33 brand was the Humburg brand. You can see the JJ was John Jones. And underneath that, the H in a square, which was August Hemme's brand. And then the final one in that row is AS for Albert Stone. Sharon, you can take it from here.
Hi, everyone. I'm Beverly's co-author, Sharon Burke, and we're looking at a scene that would have been very common in Alamo 1,000 years ago. This depicts a Tatkan village, the Tatkan, or a Bay Miwok-speaking tribe, who lived in Alamo for thousands of years. They generally lived in peace with their neighboring tribes and intermarried with them. They were hunter-gatherers, with their principal food being acorns from our oak trees. They lived near the creeks, which provided fish and fresh water to rinse the acorn mash. They gathered berries and nuts for meat. They had elk, deer, and bear, which were very plentiful. When the Stone Valley Center shopping area was developed in the 1960s, the site on which CVS Pharmacy now stands revealed a centuries-old Indian burial mound. So we know the Tatkan village was located nearby. Next slide, please. This pen and ink drawing depicts the adobe built by Jose Miguel Garcia and Rafaela Garcia in 1848. When they purchased part of Rancho Romero from their brothers-in-law, the Romeros. It was located near Austin Lane in Alamo. When the Stone family arrived in the 1850s, the Garcias were impoverished from land grant lawsuits and had to sell their adobe to the Stones. Flora Mae Stone Jones, who was born a Stone and married a Jones, thus uniting Alamo's two founding families, drew this pen and ink drawing of her childhood home around 1915. It shows a typical Mexican adobe of the period with a covered porch and a grape arbor over the porch. Next slide. This map is a simple drawing of the Mexican land grant Rancho San Ramon. It was divided in two portions. The northern half was owned by Bartolomeo Pacheco and Mariana Castro. They lived near Mission San Jose and rarely visited their lands. The southern half belonged to Jose Maria Amador, who gave his name to the Amador Valley. The boundary was approximately near modern-day Crow Canyon Road. In the 1840s, two brothers named Romero applied to Castro and Pacheco and the other landowners in the area in Walnut Creek and Lafayette for a land grant. There was plenty of land and the other landowners were agreeable. The Romeros got their grant, built an adobe and corrals and ran cattle. Their portion ran from Tice Valley south to La Serena Creek in Alamo, the creek that runs between Hemi Avenue and La Serena Drive. The Romeros later sold a portion of their land to their brothers-in-law, the Garcias, who also built adobes, one at the location of CVS in Alamo and one near Austin Lane. But the Romeros never surveyed their land as required by Mexican law. And after California became a state, they lost their title, which set off a domino effect, because then so did the Garcias lose their title, and so did the American settlers like Jones and Stone, who bought land from the Romeros and the Garcias. And the American settlers had to pay for their land twice. Next slide. This photograph depicts Silas and Susanna Stone. They came to Alamo from Iowa in 1853, settling in the valley east of San Ramon Creek that bears their name to this day. They gave their name to the road, the school, and the valley. Silas was older than many of the other settlers, already being in his 60s when he came to California. He was elected alcalde of the Alamo District, an honorific title left over from Mexican rule. Thereafter, he was known as Squire Stone. His son, Albert Ward Stone, settled in Alamo in 1858. Eventually, the Stones owned all the land from modern-day Livorna Road to Stone Valley Road. Their descendants still live in Alamo today on land their ancestors farmed. One of their descendants still grazes cattle. Some of you might remember the Alamo restaurant called Silas Stone's, which flourished in the 1980s. Together with the Jones family, the Stones were the founding settlers of Alamo. Now back to Beverly.
Thanks. You know, this picture we wanted to include for sure because it's a picture that nobody had really seen and identified as an Alamo photograph. Actually, it's an ambrotype, and it's dated around 1860. And when it first showed up and was identified as an Alamo post office building in a store, I was dubious. And fortunately, other people took it more seriously. And as it turns out, this indeed is a really early picture of a store where the post office was. And when you look at it really closely, there are signs from Dr. Howard and his wife, Jane Howard, on either side of it. And Jane was the person who took ambrotypes and very likely took this photograph. The post office was a really important part of any community. And again, people would come regularly, gather around, visit, and generally keep people from doing their jobs. But if it was in a store, it was a good place because people could make their purchases there as well. Next. And this is an interesting plat map because, as Sharon indicated, there were controversies over land titles that started with the Rancho titles. And an unscrupulous American attorney, Horace Carpentier, came and he not only acquired all kinds of land in Oakland and was very active on that side, he came to Contra Costa County. And finally, his name is on the whole Northern Rancho San Ramon. And in order for the settlers to feel secure that they owned the land, they had to pay him. And this map shows altogether, there were 65 settlers who ended up paying him $90,000 to be sure that they finally owned their property in Alamo and in Danville. Next. Another building that's particularly significant is the Union Academy. And this is a drawing by Jack Hamill, which showed how large this building was. It was the first high school in Contra Costa County and was in place with students coming from 1860 to 1868. Originally, high school discussions began with the Cumberland Presbyterian Church, and they appointed people from Lafayette, Martinez, and Alamo to decide where the school should go because they needed a high school. But each resident wanted it in his own community. So then the church appointed a committee of people who were outside of Contra Costa County, and they decided that the most logical place for the new high school would be Pacheco, which at that point was a very prominent locale and had access to a large river going to Suisun Bay. Well, nothing happened there. And finally, what happened was Alamo and Danville residents decided that they wanted the high school in their area and they were willing to put money into building this high school. And you can see it was two-story with a basement. It boarded students from all over the county and beyond. And the advantage for the people who live in Alamo and Danville was that their students could ride horseback to school and they didn't have to pay for boarding. The first Board of Education for the Union Academy included Silas Stone, Robert Love, and John Jones, and they had a number of children and were willing to spend the public time to hire the teacher, furnish the area, and support this school until it burned down one summer in 1868. Next. And here we show another school. This is Alamo School. The Alamo residents, beginning in the 1870s, had a school district, which was a grammar school district, and they built three schools altogether in the same general location, which today would be the northwest corner of Stone Valley Road and Danville Boulevard. This is just one of many pictures that we have of students in this school. And you can see just barely that there was still a belfry with a bell in the top of the school, later on taken down for fear of earthquakes. And the picture is 1913 with one of, well, the principal, either teacher or principal by that time of Ida Hall, standing in the back row. There is a historical society plaque on that corner if you want to have some other information about the grammar school. But it was here until the mid-60s when the Alamo School, 1960s, when the Alamo School moved to Wilson Road. Okay, and then one more that I want to show you is the Henry Hotel building. So this building was taken down. It was almost 100 years old, and it stood on the corner of Stone Valley Road and Danville Boulevard. And it was really the center of all kinds of activities. When it was first built, it was called the Saramone Hotel, which is something new that actually Sharon discovered, because we thought it was the Henry Hotel forever. But it was the Henry Hotel for a very long time. And as you can see here, at one point, it had an Alamo pottery store, but it had many lives as a saloon, a hotel, and as the Alamo Community Club facility, as well as the Salvation Army outpost for Japanese Americans during the 30s. Next, Sharon.
I'm going to tell you about this photograph, which depicts downtown Alamo around 1910. Not too much we can recognize in this photo. The road in the distance became Danville Boulevard. The bridge in front was the only bridge over San Ramon Creek. It is now the bridge to Alamo Square condominiums. The road leading to this bridge was then, it didn't really have a name, but it was known as the road that led to Stone Valley or the road that led to Green Valley. And it's now the road that is called Alamo Square Drive. And if the building that became Cherubini's, which we believe is the oldest building in Alamo, were in this photo, it would be in the bare space to the right of the barn you see at the left of the screen. So that locates this scene for you. It's the Humburg Ranch around 1910. Across the county road was the Jones Ranch. And you can see some hay, grain, a few orchard trees just being put out. The Joneses had a vineyard, which you can't see very well in this picture. This is a typical scene of what Alamo was for more than 100 years. Farms, ranches. The next slide depicts the elm trees that lined the west side of the boulevard from around the 1920s to the 1980s. And these trees were planted in 1923 as a memorial to soldiers lost in World War I. They were planted from Martinez south to the county line and were particularly beautiful in Alamo, people remembered. There are several instances in the historical record of Danville Boulevard through Alamo being lined with trees. In the 1870s, walnut trees came to Alamo, and many of them still remain on the boulevard, orchards that were planted up to the edge of the road. In the 1880s, August Hemme built a fabulous estate around the location of Deodar Lane today. And he brought exotic cork oak trees from Hawaii to line the road leading to his house. And he planted over 200 species of trees on his property. Finally, these trees, the elm trees, all succumbed to Dutch elm disease. Longtime Alamo residents remember the boulevard being like a tree tunnel effect. There were so many trees. And a group of volunteer Alamo residents in the early 2000s raised money to replant trees on the boulevard. And they eventually planted trees, hundreds of trees on the east side of Danville Boulevard. They called themselves the Boulevard of Trees. And those are many of the trees you see today on the east side. They planted 9 different species specifically chosen for their color, beauty, and street tree effectiveness. Next slide. This is the Alamo Station on the Southern Pacific Railroad. It was located just north of what is Creative Learning Center today, between the boulevard and the what is now the trail. Alamo did not have a downtown like Danville did. This station was built as the Hemme Station. August Hemme is a very significant person in Alamo history. He was the largest landowner. He had a lot of fruit trees and grain to send to market and was tired of sending it by horse and buggy up to Port Costa to ship out. And he talked all the other landowners in Alamo and Danville to donating right of way, because Southern Pacific would not bring the railroad to Danville and Alamo unless the right of way was donated. So this station went in on Hemme's property, and it was called the Hemme Station from about 1890 to the 1920s after August Hemme died and his large ranch was subdivided. It became the Alamo Station, as you see in this picture. There was a large warehouse next to it at the current site of Creative Learning Center, and that warehouse stored produce until it was sent to market. In the 30s, we have information that warehouse was used as a dance hall. Next slide. This wonderful picture shows the Oakland, Antioch, and Eastern Electric Railway in downtown Danville on Harts Avenue. This electric trolley had a very short life from 1914 to 1924, but it was a wonderful amenity for Danville and Alamo. The rail tracks began in downtown Oakland, tunneled through the Oakland Hills, a 3,500-foot-long tunnel, came out at Redwood Canyon, passed through the town of Canyon and Moraga and Lafayette. Olympic Boulevard today was built on the right-of-way of this trolley. At Saranac, a branch line went south, followed the current route of Tice Valley Boulevard over Crest Avenue and Alamo. There was a 70-foot-high trestle that brought this trolley over the Southern Pacific tracks to Danville Boulevard, where it ran down the east side of Danville Boulevard to Danville and turned left or east to go to Diablo Country Club. Diablo Country Club was built around 1916. It was a great thing for Valley residents. We know that the Naphthali Ranch, which is where Rossmore is today, sent wine to market on this electric trolley. Growers sent fruit and produce to market on the trolley. chickens and eggs. There were quite a lot of poultry farms in Alamo at the time. Chickens and eggs went to restaurants. We know of one Alamo resident that rode this trolley practically from her front door to downtown San Francisco, where she attended San Francisco Normal, which was a teacher's college, to become a teacher. And it was operating all during World War I, and workers went from the valley to Bay Point to the shipyards working in the war effort. And the rich folks used it to come to their big homes in Diablo every weekend. It succumbed to the popularity of the automobile and was not profitable and became defunct in 1924. Oh, next slide. A lot changed for Contra Costa County and for Alamo in 1937 when the Caldecott Tunnel was built. It provided easy access for commuters from Alamo and other Central County towns to Oakland, to Berkeley, and to San Francisco. That was the beginning of the end for Alamo as a farming town, as large orchards were split up and became subdivisions. This bevy of beauties were chosen to represent their towns at the extensive celebrations held to mark the occasion of the tunnel's opening. As you can see, they represented Alamo, Diablo, Walnut Creek, and Danville. Next to Beverly.
Thank you. So our next section, as we move to the end of our presentation, has to do with change and growth. And one of the changes that we saw in Alamo was occurred when Round Hill Country Club was developed on two ranches east of downtown Alamo. And this is a photograph that shows three of the men who were responsible for the country club. John Sparrow was one of the developers. In the center was Lawrence Hughes, who designed the golf course. And on the right was Harlan Gelderman, who was a descendant from very early pioneers in the valley and was an idea man in so many ways for the East Bay when he came and joined his father's real estate development. Alamo Improvement Association started in the 50s, and they were always very hesitant about breaking up ranches into small parcels. So it was quite a feat for Mr. Gelderman to talk Alamo Improvement Association into supporting the country club. But of course, the country club was quite a posh addition to Alamo, and the Improvement Association thought that it would be a positive way to develop those ranches. It, you know, it put Alamo on the map in lots of ways because they had international tennis stars come. I remember going and seeing Bjorn, Arthur Ashe,
and Bjorn Borg
and John Newcomb play in tennis tournaments. And in addition, they had some very outstanding women's golf tournaments, which brought people from all over the Bay Area to come and admire the new Round Hill Country Club. Next. And here, what do we have? This is a ribbon that people wore when I-680 opened. And we may complain about I-680 traffic now, and we do, but in those days, in the late 50s and 60s, as the area to and the eastern part of the Bay Area began to develop, the traffic that went down the boulevard was unbelievable. It was bumper to bumper traffic. They joked that you could have visits with your neighbor on the adjoining lane because you just sat there so long. And the freeway came through Alamo and made some major changes, one being changing the area, well, changing Stone Valley Road so that it now came straight into town. But primarily it just brought people off the boulevard so you could again have get in and out. And when they celebrated the opening in 1964, it went from Walnut Creek to Sycamore Valley Road, and they had a huge parade, which began in Alamo and concluded in Danville to celebrate this new modern interstate, which came through the valley. Next. Another thing that was very significant for Alamo was this, what's called a geoglyph on the hills above Stone Valley Road and I-680. And for those of us who lived here in the 78, 79, 80, we remember driving south on I-680 and looking up and seeing Mona Lisa on the hillside. Quite an extraordinary thing. Will Ashford was the artist who put this on the hillside. He talked the rancher into not grazing that first year. And he drew Mona Lisa on the hill and enlisted some hardy friends to come out and put fertilizer where his drawing was, so that when the rains came, Mona Lisa evolved out of the hill. And a photograph by a future Pulitzer Prize winner who was in grad school appeared in Life magazine in the special final photo section of Mona Lisa. And Mona Lisa was advertised all over the country and I think got to Europe. So we don't have that many art pieces that bring you to Alamo, but certainly Mona Lisa did. And then he also did a Marilyn Monroe on that hill following Mona Lisa. Next. Here we have a little vignette photograph of Hap McGee Ranch Park. And that's a beautiful little park that's run by Alamo Danville on the border. This particular commemorative remembers how the park got started, because in 1911, for 30 years, the San Francisco Protestant Orphanage sent children out for a sunny summer camp experience in what they called Camp Swain. So this remembers the Isaac Swain and his wife, who donated the money in the 19th century for a summer camp for the orphans. And it now is a rustic park, which has a canine corral, a wonderful array of historic buildings, one building that has brands in the floor, which is kind of a treat to see. And of course, a children's playground, which is a very popular one. So this is a park worth seeing if you haven't seen it yet. Next. And here we have a picture of the first municipal area council. This idea of having a council that was appointed or elected, but mostly appointed by the supervisor in an area, had been around for several decades. But when the Alamo incorporation effort of 2009 failed, Supervisor Pipo actually appointed the first MAC. And this is a picture. She is in the center, and two people down from her is Steve Weir, who is the county clerk, who I assume swore the new MAC in. So Alamo Improvement Association, of course, felt that they represented Alamo quite adequately. But now we have the opportunity to have both an officially appointed group in the Municipal Advisory Committee and the Alamo Improvement Association to respond to projects and set priorities for Alamo. You can look up the Alamo MAC anytime, and it's a place where people can go and talk about things that are of significance to them. So this is our modern governance board, and they are, if I'm recognizing it correctly, in the cottage at Hat McGee Ranch Park. Sharon?
This final slide, I imagine if you showed this to anyone in the county that knew about Alamo, they would instantly identify this as Alamo, because this means Alamo to most people. The southeast corner of Danville Boulevard and Stone Valley Road. And what you are looking at, the shoe repair building, was initially built as Alamo's post office in 1937, and it was on the corner of Las Trompas Road and Danville Boulevard. It was moved to this location in 1944, along with the Quonset Hut in back, that was built as a supermarket, Alamo's first supermarket. And it had several refrigerator cabinets inside, and people used to come and get their fresh produce. The building in front was variously served as a jewelry store and a real estate office after it wasn't the post office anymore. The building in back was an auto repair store for a while and became the Alamo Hay and Grain Store in 1979. Alamo's history is closely tied to horses. There were many famous Arabian horse ranches in Alamo. There were also horse ranches that raised race horses. And the equestrian history of Alamo is quite extensive. So the Alamo Hay and Grain flourished for a long time, providing feed to horse ranches. I used to get chicken feed there for my chickens. The owner of Alamo Hay and Grain put the fiberglass horse on the top of the shoe repair shop in the 1980s. He thought it would attract people off the boulevard. Monta Vista and Saramon high school students used to make it a prank to take the horse down. John got tired of that and bolted it to the roof eventually, and it's been there ever since. Sadly, the Hay and Grain went defunct about 3 years ago after John Bolandi died, and the whole parcel is currently for sale. But still, the iconic symbol of Alamo and honors Alamo's horsey history. So I think that's the last slide.
Okay. Thank you, Sharon and Beverly. And we've got some questions for you. Can you share anything about the Indian burial ground that was discovered when 680 was being built across from La Serena Avenue?
Beverly, I don't know about that. I'm not sure if you do or not. I know only about the one that was at the location of CVS.
Yes, there. Evidently, the Indians had the good sense to see a wonderful place to live that we see today. And in the 60s, as the freeway was being built, and I don't know whether this was coincidental, there were three areas in which Indian artifacts and some graves were discovered. The two that most people know about were on both sides of Saramon Creek. Well, really, one side of Saramon Creek in downtown Alamo, which the first one appeared because they were changing the alignment of the creek, and they found several layers of Indian occupancy and did quite a, Sonoma State did a, large archaeological salvage dig there, finding out that people had lived there over 5,000 years. And the one to the south of Alamo was also discovered at that point, with many of the same kinds of projectile points and abalone regalia discovered in those locations.
Okay. Jeffrey had asked about the high school located near what street? And I think it's Union Academy that he's referring to.
Yeah. So if you look on the west side of Danville Boulevard across from Ceremon Valley Methodist Church and El Portal, you'll see a sign that commemorates Union Academy. And that's where it was. It was on the north west side of the boulevard and Rutherford Creek.
Okay. Steve Minier, who I think a lot of us know, chimed in with the last slide, which I had made some comments to earlier about the high school prank on the horse disappearing at various times. And so, yeah, he got some fun out of that one, as I did. Cherubini's, is that the old Welty home?
I'm not aware of people named Welty. That was a granary, a grain storage building on the Humber Ranch. And during World War II, it was very difficult to find building materials. And Lorenz Humberg needed a home for his family, two little girls at the time and his wife. And he moved the granary there from elsewhere on the Humberg Ranch. And it was the Humberg family home. An elderly resident, two elderly residents of Alamo grew up in that home when it was the Humberg home. I don't think it was ever associated with another family.
Okay. We did have a claim made on one of the bevy of beauties. Charles wrote in and said that the girl on the right, he used the word woman, but girl on the right was his mother, Mildred Lewis Ferreira.
Very cool.
Yeah, I thought so too. The Bola property on Stone Valley Road, the question was it ever an orchard?
Are they talking, I wasn't sure if the questioner was talking about the currently vacant property or the Bola Ranch in general, which became Bola Avenue, East Lane, parts of Miranda Avenue, generally the area between Stone Valley Road and Stone Valley School. It was walnut orchards in the early 20th century.
Sharon, you had mentioned something about wine being chipped out of Alamo on the railroad. Wine in Alamo?
Well, Beverly, I'm going to tell the story about the wine researcher that contacted us. Just recently, in the last 2 weeks, a lady read our book that her field is researching wineries in California, and she was surprised to find there was wine and vineyards in Alamo. We told her we knew of one winemaker. His name was James Marengo. He lived at the eastern end of Livorno Road. He had 83 acres. He came from Italy. He tunneled wine cellars into the hill behind his house. He used Miranda Creek for water, and his grandson still lives on the property today. He made wine until Prohibition put him out of business. And the Jones family, that their property became Alamo Plaza, we don't know that they made wine, but they definitely had a vineyard there for many years. And perhaps their grapes went to James Marengo to make into wine. We don't really know about that, but it certainly was something the first settlers did, grow grapes. The winery I mentioned was what became Rossmore, the Naphthali Ranch in the late 19th century.
There are some beautiful pictures of the Jones vineyard with you know, looking toward Mount Diablo with a big oak tree in it. And Josephine Fowler Jones talked about that vineyard, because when she moved into the Jones house as a young bride, they still had the vineyards there. And the wine was made elsewhere, and the Joneses would get, I guess, a couple kegs back for their own use. What happened with that vineyard was the phylloxera, I'm probably pronouncing it wrong, came through and destroyed the vineyards. And so they had to make a decision about whether they were going to replant vineyards or plant walnuts. And they decided to plant walnuts in that property.
Okay. So we've covered grapes and walnuts, I think, but what were the largest farm crops for Alamo farmers?
I would say it's very little known. In the late 19th century, 1860s, 70s, 80s, Contra Costa County was one of the premier wheat growing areas in America. We always think of it as being Kansas and Nebraska, but it was Contra Costa County. It was something called Contra Costa White, and it sold for premium prices. It was particularly hard and made very good quality flour. It sold for premium prices on the Liverpool Corn Exchange, which was the grain exchange in Europe. And they grew hay, according to Virgie Jones's books, they grew hay in Alamo late into the 20th century as well, which would make sense as we had numerous horse ranches. Walnuts, and then pears. There's still many old pear trees in Alamo left over from the pear orchards. And like Beverly showed in the slide, that was peach orchard, prune orchards, fruits and nuts.
Okay. It surprises me. I come from an area that had trolleys as well. And they seem like such great ideas for every community that they're in, including modern versions, I think. What's your take on the trolley? And you could see in that one slide the demise of the trolley being off to the left of it, the automobiles lined up on the street.
Well, you know, it had its time. And unfortunately, the timing was not the best, because that is just when the internal combustion engine became popular. And that idea that you could use farm trucks instead of horses meant a major change in how many animals were on farms and how much hay was needed. And the cars and trucks simply outcompeted the trolley. It was the Oakland, Antioch, and Eastern Electric, from which Danville had a branch, that was quite the extraordinary piece, because you know you had if you had transit, you had Southern Pacific Railroad going north south, and then you had the electric going east west. And Sharon mentioned the extraordinary Redwood Tunnel, which was built in 1911, which allowed people to come eventually with the Sacramento Northern from Chico through Sacramento, over the Delta, through Contra Costa, through the tunnel, into Oakland, and to the ferry, or in the 30s, on the bridge. And so it was very luxurious cars as well. I mean, you traveled in nice comfort in the Sacramento Northern, for sure. So I think it's a very cool history.
Yeah.
For our area. And much of the Lafayette Moraga regional trail is on the right of way for that original trolley.
Okay. Jeffrey wants to know what kind of famous people have lived in Alamo? and I'm not sure, let's put famous in quotes.
Well, I'm going to jump in here first because I've been doing some more research just kind of for fun, and none of these stories made it to the book. Nowadays, famous people who have a lot of money tend to live in Alamo. I think most people know Stephen Curry used to live here, and Christy Yamaguchi lives here, and LaRussa lives here, et cetera, sports stars and celebrities. But this is just going to be a teaser. I may do an article for Alamo Danville today. I've discovered a very famous criminal that lived in Alamo for 20 years. He was a land swindler, and the U.S. government pursued him all that time till he finally ended up in prison. And on the day he got out of prison, he had a heart attack and died. And when he died, it was headlines all over America. So that was certainly a very famous person. I found a famous racehorse owner who was a retired sea captain. Again, you're talking 1910, 1915, so nobody alive today would remember these people. But when they were living, there were lots of articles about them. I'm not sure, trying to think of anybody in the 30s, 40s, or 50s who lived in Alamo. If you've ever heard of the Buck Foundation, I think the founders lived in Alamo. Oh, this is a fun one. If you remember Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, which was a very famous film, and there was a mine owner at the end when Butch and Sundance went to South America. There was a mine owner that hired them to be guards for the payroll. Well, that mine owner was from the San Ramon Valley. His father was one of the first settlers in Alamo. So that's kind of cool.
Yeah, that was fun. So everybody's got to now chime back in and go watch Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Oh, he's played by Strother Martin. He's quite a good character, minor part, but quite a good character.
I remember the scene. Yeah.
And that was the Glass family
that went on to be one of the major families in San Ramon, but the origins were in Alamo.
Okay. I think that's it for questions, guys. And I want to thank you for your presentation. Catherine actually is leading me right into this one. She sent in a question about this book. And so people that have tuned in today, on Saturday, November the 20th at the museum here, Beverly and Sharon will have a special book signing of their book, Historic Tales of Alamo. In the book, there's the ambrotype of the Alamo Post Office. Mona Lisa graces the back cover. And so if you want more information on Alamo, or you know somebody that grew up here and is homesick for Alamo, remember the holidays are coming, this wouldn't be a bad idea. So Saturday, November 20th, 11 to 1, I think is the time, right? Is that right?
That's right.
11 to 1, here at the museum, special book signing. Great present for somebody. And I'd like to thank you all for viewing this morning. If you've missed any of our earlier programs, you can find them by visiting the museum's website at museumsrv.org. And today's program will appear early next week. Our next program will be on December the 16th at 11:30. Mary McCusker and Mary Salon, historians and authors of a book on the Caldecott Tunnel, and they'll give us the history of the Caldecott and its construction. Many of us have to negotiate that every day, so this will be great to hear about. And Chuck can come back in and see if his mother and the rest of the bevy of beauties makes a slide in that show too. So next December 16th at 11:30, if you like these programs and want them to continue, we ask you to make a donation to the museum by going to the museum's homepage, museumsrv.org, and clicking on the Donate Now button. Also, the museum's always interested in volunteers and always in need of them. So if you can give us some time, please contact the museum. I hope you enjoyed today's presentation. Thank you, Beverly and Sharon, and stay safe. And thank you for watching.
Bye.